Welcome to Washed by the Word. I'm Pastor Khan, and I wanted to personally welcome you to our Sunday morning service as we go verse by verse through God's Word. It's our desire here by Washed by the Word that the Spirit of God will speak to you intimately as we go verse by verse through His Word. So welcome again to our Sunday morning service, and I look forward to hearing from all of you, sharing with us what God has shown you today as you get washed by the Word.
All right, we are going to be in the Gospel of Luke this morning. We normally, as you know, on Sunday mornings are in the book of Ephesians. We'd be in Ephesians chapter 4, typically, but with it being Christmas Day, we're going to just look at the Christmas story. We're just going to read through the Christmas story and see what God might have for us today. Luke chapter 2, we'll just look at the first 20 verses. It's an old, old story. Most of us are familiar with it, but it's always new. And people who love Jesus never tire of hearing it. It's just awesome. We're going to break it up into three little sections and just see what God might have for us today. We're going to look at the birth of Jesus. And we're going to see how the birth of Jesus drew Joseph and Mary to Bethlehem in the first seven verses. We're also going to see that the birth of Jesus drew some angels from heaven because of the birth of Jesus. And we're going to see how the birth of Jesus drew some shepherds from the fields because of the birth of Jesus. So we're going to just kind of look at a very basic reading here in Luke chapter 2. It says in verse 1, "And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was, while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn," the first section. Notice at the very beginning, it talks about this decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. Caesar Augustus was ruling. He was the man, the most powerful man in the civilized world at that time. He was ruling, but God was in charge. Don't ever forget that, guys. We have men who rule, but God is in charge. We can't help but think of King Uzziah over in Isaiah chapter 6, right? It says there, "In the year that King Uzziah died," Isaiah says, "I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple." King Uzziah had ruled for 52 years and had done a good job most of the time until towards the end of his life, but he was the man. Can you imagine having the same ruler for 52 years? England right now is seeing their queen get really sick, and they're starting to get nervous. That's just a figurehead ruler. King Uzziah was the ruler. And Isaiah writes, "In the year that he died, I saw that God was still on the throne." That's very comforting, is it not? God is in charge. And here we see, it came to pass in those days, this decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the whole world should be registered. God was controlling the events of humanity, just as he is today on a national level, as he does on a personal level. Hang on to that. Hang on to that. God's got you, man. If you know Jesus, God has you. And if you don't, the fact that you're here, he has you. And it's a matter of saying, "I'm going to stop running. It's time." God is in charge. Well, God used this Caesar Augustus as he had the idea. Every 14 years, you know, they took a census, and you'd have to register your name, your occupation, your property, your family, go to your hometown throughout the Roman Empire. Well, here in this section of land, there was Joseph up there, and he was from the city of David, it said. So he had to go down to Bethlehem, the city of David, to register. An order from Caesar Augustus, planned from eternity past by God, that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem, not Nazareth. And God uses the authority in Joseph's life, an authority that he was not, more likely than not, all that fired up about. A foreign authority, someone he didn't agree with. If you're a Democrat here today, it would have been a Republican leader. And if you're a Republican, it would have been a Democrat leader. But it was the leader. And God used him to achieve God's perfect will. So important for us that we become Christians when it comes to our nationality. And that we live a Christian life, coming under the authority that God places over our life, whether it be on a government level, a working level, a school level, a family level. So important. Well, he goes on down to Bethlehem. We remember that God had promised that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem, Micah 5:2. In Isaiah, it said he'd be born of a virgin, he'd be born in Bethlehem, he'd be from the tribe of Judah, he'd be from the family of David, he would be a Jew, not a Gentile, he would be a human, not a spiritual being, but a human being, and we see Jesus being fully God, fully man, and we start to see God's plan being played out as God starts to direct the path of Joseph and Mary. And they come to Bethlehem, and Bethlehem is a very insignificant city as far as population goes. Tiny little place. Today, it's still insignificant. It's 5 miles south of Jerusalem. Many of you have been there with us on our Israel trips. You know what Bethlehem's like. It's a place I look forward to ever having to go again. You go to Bethlehem once, it's good. It's good. Many other places in Israel I'd rather be than Bethlehem, but if you're going to Israel, you've got to go to Bethlehem one time. So we go to Bethlehem one time, and we get done, and people go, phew, I'm going to take a shower, I'm out. And it's crazy, we go back to Israel on a regular basis, and those who go back with us usually say, can we just stay at the hotel when you guys do Bethlehem? That's Bethlehem. It's insignificant. And that's where Jesus was born. Think about that. He was born in an insignificant little town, but that was extremely significant because Jesus was there. And oh, if we can get that concept. I don't care how much money you have. I don't think how big and important you think you are, how handsome you think you are, how pretty you think you are. You're going to get old and die. And you're going to be very insignificant unless Jesus is born in you. But if Jesus is born in you, insignificant suddenly becomes very significant. And they go to Bethlehem. Now, Bethlehem was interesting because David was born in Bethlehem. That made it kind of like, well, that's interesting. In fact, David was called, remember, the beloved. Benjamin, those of you in the Old Testament class, remember the youngest son of Israel or of Jacob, was born to Rachel right outside of Bethlehem. Benjamin means the son of my right hand. And it's interesting that Benjamin and David were both born in Bethlehem. It was known as the city of David at this time. But what's interesting is David, the beloved, and Benjamin, the son of my right hand, Jesus, as he starts to grow up and shows himself as the Messiah, is called the beloved. Remember, in the baptism of Jesus, the Father looks at him, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. And again, over in the Gospels, we see that Benjamin, the son of my right hand, we see the Lord speaking about going to his father's right hand. We see scripture talking about him being seated at the right hand. So it's just an interesting little thing that we look at, but here is Joseph and Mary going to Bethlehem to fulfill the prophecy of Micah 5:2 that the Messiah would be born there in Bethlehem, the Messiah. The Hebrew word Mishach in the Greek, it's Christos. In English, we transliterate it into Christ. It means the anointed one. It is that one promised in the Old Testament scriptures. It is not the last name of Jesus. We talk about that all the time. It was not Jesus Christ. It wasn't Joseph Christ, Mary Christ, and their little baby Jesus Christ. No, it's Joseph and Mary and their little baby Jesus, who was the anointed one, who was the promised Messiah, the one who fulfilled all the prophecies in the Old Testament concerning the coming of the Messiah at this first coming of Jesus. and they go to Bethlehem to fulfill another one of those prophecies, the Micah 5:2 prophecy. But then as we go on, we look at Caesar sitting in his palace, say, we need to register, thinking he's got it all figured out. 8 years ago, we heard there was going to be hope we could believe in. He had it all figured out. Now we hear, going to make America great again. He's got it all figured out. No, they don't. But God does. God has it all figured out. God's got a perfect plan. And we're going to come under the authority of whoever leads our country. But we're going to trust in God. Because he's on the throne. And he's leading our lives individually and nationally according to his perfect will. That's why we don't lose sleep at night. That's why we don't freak out over events. Are you serious? God's in control. We're going to watch him. And we're going to be the best stinking citizens this nation's ever seen because we love Jesus. So we're not going to mock politicians. We're going to come under the authority of the politicians. Are we going to agree with everything they say? Probably not. Are we going to agree with everything they do? Probably not. But we're going to come under the authority that God has placed in our life. And we're going to be good citizens is unto Christ, because that's who we are. And that is our testimony. That's our testimony. Well, Caesar had no idea what a huge role he was playing in history. He had no idea. It was A.T. Pearson who said, history, if you break it up, is his story. History is nothing but the story of God intervening in our lives, bringing us to that perfect end, the second coming of Jesus Christ, when the rapture of the church will take place, will be caught up in the clouds in glory. He will usher in that 7-year tribulation period, and then Jesus will come again for a brief, brief cleanup operation at the Battle of Armageddon, and then usher the true believers on into eternity. We have a glorious future. And it is so insignificant whether a wall is built or not. That's not the issue. It's the wall that we have placed between us and God because of our sin. That's the issue. And we saw in the book of Ephesians in chapter 2, Jesus came and he broke down that wall so that we can now come to Christ. So we need to calm ourselves, keep our eyes on eternal things. Life is going to happen. We're going to be disappointed. Some of us will probably sin. Any sinners in the house? Okay, we'll probably sin. But we're going to repent of our sin. We're going to confess our sin, repent of our sin, place our faith in Jesus Christ, and we're going to go forward. Because God is a God of grace and mercy and forgiveness. That's how we're going to live our life. That's how we're going to live our life. We're not going to hold resentment and unforgiveness and bitterness. Our Bibles tell us bitterness rots the bones. And nobody got time for that. So we're just going to let it go. And we're going to love Jesus. We're going to forgive folk. We're going to forgive people even if they don't ask us for forgiveness. Can you imagine? We're just going to forgive. We're not going to go up and tell them we forgive them. We're just going to forgive them. We're going to let God work in their heart, and eventually they will come up and say, will you forgive me? And we're going to say, of course I forgive you. You already have. Amen. Then you just extend that forgiveness. But if you wait for them, you're going to get bitter. And when you get bitter, you get wrinkles. No, I'm just playing, but that gets your attention, doesn't it? So don't hold on to unforgiveness. You lose. You lose. Forgive. When they come and ask for it, you give it to them. You already have it. You forgave a long time ago. We let it go. Our Bible tells we're to forgive one another just as God in Christ Jesus has forgiven us. So we forgive. We just forgive. Please forgive me because I am going to offend pretty much everyone in you one time or another because that's just who I am. But realize you offend everybody in here too. I know we all feel we're perfect, not me, you know, but no, we do. So if I offend you, you come to me. And what do you say? You offended me. And I go, sorry, will you forgive me? And you're going to say, I already did. Okay, done. We're done. But oftentimes we don't know we've been offensive unless someone tells us. And we sit there and we appease our flesh and say, well, if that's the way they are, I'm just And we sit there and we appease our flesh and say, well, if that's the way they are, I'm just going to wait. And you're going to grow bitter. And the person who offended you doesn't even know they have. They're going to sleep like a baby and you're going to be awake all night long. That's crazy. So let people know, you know, you hurt my feelings. You offended me. Don't defend yourself. Say, I am so sorry. Will you forgive me? Don't be surprised when you come to church and you get offended. Be surprised when you come to church and you don't get offended. Say, whoa, praise God, nobody offended me today. This was amazing. It's okay. It's okay. So, history, his story. President James Garfield, a true born-again Christian, said this, history is the unrolled scroll of prophecy. Could you imagine what it'd be like to have a president who's addicted to prophecy? That would be fun. Garfield was. He was a prophecy student. How cool is that? That is just, I love that. I love that. God says this, and you know, it's fun to hear Pearson, it's fun to hear a president, but this is what God says. He says, I'm watching over my word to perform it. I've given these prophecies. I'm watching over my word, and they're going to come to pass. That's a promise from God. So here is Joseph and Mary living up in Nazareth. And all of a sudden, Caesar Augustus says, we need to have a census down in Bethlehem. He just says in your home city, which just happens to be Bethlehem, which just happens to fill Micah 5:2. And all of a sudden, the edict goes out just at the right time. And it says, you need to go back to Bethlehem, Joseph. Come on, Mary, let's go. And off they go. Notice what it says in verse 4. So Jesus also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem. How interesting, called Bethlehem. It literally means the house of bread. What a great place for the bread of life to be born. No, but there he is in Bethlehem. Because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. And there is, in the conservative Jewish mindset right there, a serious oxymoron, a betrothed wife who was with child. And a Jew who would read that, an Orthodox Jew who would read that, they would definitely look at that and go, what? What do you mean a betrothed wife with child? Those two things don't go together. Now, you've heard of it many, many times, and you know this whole thing about the betrothal in Judaism. And how in Judaism, when you were betrothed, you had a marriage, a legal marriage, but it was an incomplete marriage. But you were married. You were married in every aspect of the word, except you were not living together. You were not cohabitating. You were not having physical relationships, but you were married legally. You were betrothed. In fact, in the Old Testament, it is mentioned twice where the betrothed person, the female, is referred to as a wife. So one is where David calls for the daughter, Michal of Ishbosheth, right after he takes the throne. And he says to Abner, bring me my betrothed wife, Michal. So there the betrothed woman was called a wife. And that was very typical. We see it here too. They're a wife, but not a complete marriage. It's an incomplete marriage until the day of the marriage. We won't get into that. We've talked about that many times and how it relates specifically to the rapture of the church, the coming of Jesus and all. It's an amazing picture that the Lord uses in that. But here we just see Mary is this betrothed wife to Joseph. And remember, they're not to have any physical relations. And yet it tells us here that she was with child. Let's take a look at the other Christmas passage for a second in Matthew chapter 1. And if you're reading the Christmas stories, guys, there's two Gospels that contain the Christmas story. Luke chapter 2 is the one we're reading now. And we're going to just read verses 18 to 23 here or so, maybe 20. Yeah, we're going to go through 25. And this is the other account of the Christmas story. And then in chapter 2, time goes back about two more years, and we get to chapter 2 where the wise men come. So the wise men come 2 years after the birth of Jesus. We'll see why in just a minute here, but let's take a look at chapter 1, verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a righteous or a just man, not wanting to make a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She's going to bring forth a son, and you're going to call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall be with child, bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, took to him his wife, and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, called his name Jesus. If we go to chapter 2, verse 1, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judah in the days of Herod the king, and it goes on, if you read chapter 2 of Matthew, you will notice that all of a sudden, let's take a look at verse 7. You'll see where it shows up here. Then Herod, speaking to these magi coming, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared, and he sent them to Bethlehem, says, go and search carefully for the young child. The word that is used in the Greek there is what we would call a toddler. It's no longer a baby. And throughout the account of chapter 2, it's this term toddler, 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 toddler. And it's just an amazing thing because I know Dillard says, no, the wise men are in the manger scene. Just look, you know. But they're not. They're 2 years later. If you want to have a biblical manger scene, take the wise men. And if you live up on Eubank in Montgomery, put the wise men maybe like in Rio Rancho. And say, it'll take a couple of years to get here. But they're going to come, but they're just not part of the manger scene. They're not there yet. They're coming. It's coming. But let's get back into Luke chapter 2. In Luke chapter 2, he says he's there with his betrothed wife. And now we see from Mark chapter 1 that she was pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God had come upon her. So we see in verse 6, so it was while they were there in Bethlehem, chapter 2 of Luke, verse 6, the days were completed for her to be delivered. She brought forth her firstborn son. In the Gospels, we see that Joseph and Mary had other children. Those of us from a Catholic background, we kind of go back on our heels and say, no, now you're starting to talk trash, but that's what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that. So we're going to stand on the Word of God here. So it's the firstborn son. If you want their names, the Gospels have a couple of places where they list the brothers of Jesus there. So it was while I was there, she brought forth her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and it was the Hebrew way of wrapping. And the Navajo, our Navajo brothers and sisters, sometimes when your babies are born, you wrap your babies on that board, right? And they wrap them so their posture's real straight. Is that right, Sean? I've heard it. I've seen a couple of them. I think that's a Navajo tradition. The Jews had a very similar tradition in that they would wrap the arms and the legs of a baby, and then that would be called putting him in swaddling clothes. It was the Jewish tradition. So now she's wrapping this baby in swaddling clothes, and she lays him in a manger. Interesting, the manger, again, Dillard's, you know. Tito had to leave, or is he here? He's back there. Okay. Tito works at Dillard's, and I was going to have fun with Tito today. But at any rate, you go to Dillard's, and we see the manger scene. We know what it's like. We see it. It's got the nice wood and the hay, and it's got the nice little lean-to there, and you know, we see it. When we go to Israel, the first tour day, we go to Solomon's stables, and we get to see feed troughs, also known as mangers. And we see all these mangers. Sid and Lois Sinsky, what are they made of? They're stone. They're stone mangers. And they're pretty good-sized mangers. Are my middle daughter, Christy, when she was 8, they had her sit. And she's a tall girl. She's 6'1 now. And at 8, she was like tall. But they had her get in a manger for a picture. And she fit in that manger, kind of. She had her legs up to her knees, you know, or up to her chin, but she could get in the manger. But they're about this big. And it's made out of stone. Those of you who went with us 4 years ago, Walter and Stephanie, 4 years ago, you remember we went to the cave, that restructure of a cave outside of Bethlehem. And we saw the cave that typically seems to fit what the scripture is teaching. And I know Dillard says, no, it's made out of wood. But when we go to Israel, we see it's made out of stone. So it's a different picture. It's just like, well, this is kind of messing up my head. Yeah, but that's what it is. So they took Jesus, Mary took Jesus, she wrapped him in swaddling clothes, laid him in a feed trough. Then it goes on. Now, there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, when we see behold, we typically think, wow, wow. So they're out there and wow, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord. Can you imagine? You're out camping out with your sheep, and there's an angel shows up. But that's enough to freak me right there. But the glory of the Lord? Are you stinking kidding me? It's like, whoa. We're talking shepherds now. We want to remember who the shepherds were. There are some who believe these were temple shepherds watching over the Passover lambs at the time. Maybe. I'm not going to say they weren't. I wasn't there. But I do know that shepherds, for the most part, were the dregs of society. They rode on lowrider camels. They traveled in packs. When shepherds came to town, people closed the doors. The shepherds were not allowed to testify. I find that so interesting. If there was an accident, two camels hit each other. If your witness is a shepherd, his testimony doesn't count because he just can't trust a shepherd. Some of us are sitting here today and say, I understand, I can relate with shepherds. I come to town, they close the shutters on me. I tell a story, they go, mm-hmm. That's a shepherd. It's a shepherd mindset. That's the first human beings that God presented the glorious message of the incarnation, that he was coming to earth. That's the ones he tapped to go tell people. Think about that. Talk about being unqualified. Talk about being the bottom on the bottom rung of society. That's who God reaches for. We're going to look at that in just a minute, but I just find that so interesting. But the shepherds are also known as the bad boys, you know. They're the shepherds. You had to do something to freak out the shepherds. The shepherds were shepherds. They were men's men. Don't mess with a shepherd. You're a lion, a bear, don't mess with a shepherd. You'll be dead. He's a shepherd. And it says here, the glory of the Lord showed around them, and guess what? They were afraid. Notice what it says. It doesn't even say they were afraid. It says they were greatly afraid. They freaked out. They freaked out the shepherd. So all of us bad boys in here, we got to calm ourselves because the glory of God is going to freak us out. We're really not as tough as we want people to think, are we? But here are the shepherds, and they're greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, hey, don't be afraid. I love that. Calm yourself. For behold, for wow, I'm bringing you good tidings of great joy, which will be to, and if you write in your Bible, you might circle the word all people. All people. I looked up the word all. Most of you know the word allos in the Greek. You know what it means. What does all mean? You know it. It means all. So you can circle that, not just to the Jews. This is going to be great joy, which will be to all people. If you're a person, this is some good news of great joy for you. God came that you can have life and have life abundantly. And that's what this story is about. Did it take place in December 25th? Probably not. The shepherds weren't stupid. And you go over to Israel right now, it's cold and snowy out there. They're not going to be in the fields. They're going to be in the caves. They're going to be warm. They're not going to be singing. So probably not December 25th. But December 25th was the day when a Roman emperor created a holiday celebrating the unconquerable sun, S-U-N, because the days start getting longer. It was the winter solstice. But it's not important that it was this day. When the Christians came on the scene in the 4th century, what did the Christians do? They said, we're going to celebrate that same holiday where they share gifts and they bring greenery into the house to celebrate the lengthening of the days. But we're going to celebrate not the unconquerable S-U-N, we're going to celebrate the unconquerable S-O-N. And we're going to commemorate the birth of Jesus right here. So if you want to celebrate Christmas December 25th like most of the world has for centuries, that's cool. That's cool. Celebrate. Say, not me. I want to celebrate January 6th. Well, that's cool. Celebrate January 6th. You want to celebrate April 3rd? That's cool. Celebrate April 3rd. If you want to celebrate every day of your life, that's even better. We just celebrate the fact that God came into our world, into our life, and we can have life and have life abundantly because of Jesus Christ. That's what we celebrate. Now, nostalgia is fun. It's fun to have Kurt up here one time a year. I'm not much into Christmas carols, as you can tell. I'm out there. I don't like Christmas carols. I don't like them. You know that. You've been with me 28 years. Kurt knows that. He likes them. I don't. We agree to disagree. That's just us. But when I sing a Christmas carol, I end up myself, I'm just talking for me, I end up worshiping nostalgia. When I sing a Christmas carol, I think of a little boy growing up, gifts under a tree, snow up in Minnesota. I'm not thinking about Jesus. I'm not. I'm just being honest. That's me. Now, if you can sing a Christmas carol and worship Jesus, God bless you. I struggle that. I just do. So even today, I said, Kurt, throw a couple of worship songs in there for me, right? Put a couple in there and then do all the Christmas carols. It's Christmas. But I love to worship Jesus. And there's certain music and songs and words that bring me right into his presence. And others, I have to really fight my flesh because I go back to nostalgia. That's just me. I'm not saying they're wrong. They're not from Satan. I've got the problem, not the Christmas carols. That's my problem. I'm selfish that way. So I just say, let's not do too many Christmas carols. Christmas Day, okay, but that's just me. That's just me. So we look at this. He says, for there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ, the Anointed One, the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. So the angel's talking to these shepherds, these good old boys out there in the field, and they're freaking out. And the angel says, don't freak out. Messiah is coming, and you're going to find him in Bethlehem. And he says, you're going to find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. He's going to be lying in a feeding trough. I would have thought he'd be in the Temple Mount, wouldn't you? Messiah's coming. He'll be in Jerusalem in the Temple Mount. All the high priests will be there. All the priests will be there. We're going to have a lot of sacrifices and offerings. We're going to have all the Levites there. We're going to have a four-hour worship service. We're going to read all the prophecies. And then, behold, boom, there's Jesus. No, he goes into the field with a bunch of shepherds living out in the fields. And he says, you go there and you're going to find this babe wrapped up, laying in a feeding trough. That's your Messiah. Can you imagine? And suddenly, they hear that. Before they can even question it, suddenly there was with the angel a multitude. A multitude. That's a lot. A multitude's a bunch. There's a multitude of the heavenly host, and they're praising God. And in the New Testament, we never see angels singing. They're always saying. They're saying it again. A multitude of heavenly hosts praising and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. At the creation of everything, we see from Job chapter 38 that the angels were singing. Now, at the incarnation, we see them praising God again. So the angels are praising God, and they say, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Interesting, this word peace here. Peace has to do not so much with the external. This word peace in the original language speaks of an internal character relationship. It was said that during this time, times were pretty tough. The taxes were high. Unemployment was high. Morality was low. It was a rough time. There was enforced peace, the Pax Romana, but it was a type of peace that if you didn't toe the line, they just killed you. And if you kill enough people for, you know, going over 70 miles an hour, pretty soon nobody goes over 70 miles an hour. You learn. Where's Con? Well, he's going 74. What? What happened? They killed him. I guarantee you, when that speedometer gets up to about 65, you're starting to slow that baby down. And you're going to just calm yourself. That's what was going on in Rome. People were being killed for insurrection, but that was defined by basically anything they wanted it to be. So you needed to toe the line. So it was a difficult time. It was a very tough time at this time. And now he says, glory to God in the highest, on earth peace and goodwill toward men. Not peace and a cross, but peace and goodwill toward men. Back at the time that Jesus was born, people were being crucified literally by the thousands every year. And now they're saying, no, there's going to be peace and it's going to be goodwill toward men. So this word peace here doesn't speak so much about the circumstances that can be brought about. It speaks about the character that can happen when we put our faith in this promised Messiah. It's a whole different type of word for peace here. This is going to be this peace on the inside, not peace on the outside. It was, I wrote it down really small. Here it is. It was a guy by the name, it's not important, Epictetus, some old Greek guy. But this is what he said. He says, the emperor may give peace from war on land and war on sea. But the emperor is unable to give peace from passion, grief, and envy. The emperor can never give peace of heart. And that's the peace here that the angels are talking about. He says, he's come to give you peace of heart. The angels come and give the message. Then, of all things, we look again and we see it's the shepherds. Here's the message. He goes to the shepherds. God often calls the poor and the lowly to bring him glory. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, it says he uses the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. So, we see it from the get-go. It's the shepherds that he goes to. As we see him going to these shepherds, notice what it says in verse 15. So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, well, let's go to Bethlehem and let's see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. And they came with haste. We talk about it all the time. Every Christmas, you know what I'm going to say? They came with haste, the first Christmas rush, right there. But they came with haste, and they found Mary. And the word found there in the original language is to find something after really searching for it. So they hit Bethlehem, they got into Bethlehem, they're starting to look. And they're looking at all the feed troughs, looking for a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes. And they're looking, and they're looking, and they're looking, and they found Mary and Joseph and the babe. Not that toddler word, but the baby here. The baby lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, Jesus, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child, and all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorified and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen as it was told them. How interesting. God speaks to the shepherds, those who do not have the platform, so to speak, to make this type of announcement, one would think. But God goes to the grassroots, literally. He goes to the fields. And he goes to the shepherds, society's outcasts. So I'm going to show you Jesus. And we can learn from verses 15 through 20 something that applies to us today. What do we do? Oh, to be like the shepherds. We can't say we don't speak well enough. We can't say we don't have enough education. We have no excuse. They had seen Jesus. They had found Jesus. And now that they found Jesus, they told others, I found Jesus. And you know, guys, that's what it means to share your faith. You don't have to have a Bible degree to share your faith. It's telling others that you found Jesus, what he's done to your life, and let the results lie in the hands of the Spirit of God. You don't have to talk anybody into coming to Christ. If I can talk somebody in, someone else can talk them out. Some circumstance can bring them out. But I can share what the Lord has done with me. And if people truly put their faith in Christ, for real, as the Spirit of God draws them to Him, then they're flat out born again and saved. Simple as that. Can't be talked out. They're there. Our responsibility, share what the Lord has done in our life. Now, when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. All those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept these things, pondered them in her heart. Notice verse 20. Then the shepherds returned. They went back to the field. Can you imagine? They just saw the creator of the universe. They just saw the Messiah. And they're telling people about Jesus. And then they went back to work. I think there's a lesson for us there. How important it is to return as a new man, a new woman, to the old job God has called us to. It doesn't mean, well, I'm a Christian now, I guess I'm going to quit. No, you're a Christian now. Be faithful to what God has called you. Shine bright for God right there. And if God takes you somewhere and leads you somewhere else, then go with it. But don't quit. Shine bright for God where He has us planted. Bloom where we're planted. So we see them returning. So notice we've got a receiving, a responding, a reported, a returning. The last one was very easy. They returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen as it was told them. They left rejoicing. Our brother here from, I forgot the name of your country already, Southern Africa. I can picture Africa. Zambia. Our brother from Zambia. I loved what he said. Wake up. So we got a Savior. They were rejoicing and praising God. They were glorifying and praising God. They were rejoicing. I found it interesting, and this is not a slam, it's just a jealous Viking fan, but when he mentioned the Cowboys, that was the loudest response we had all morning. People got all fired up over those Cowboys. And you know, it's really possible. It's really possible. With Dak and Elliott, you might win the Super Bowl, Cowboys. You might win it. It could happen. But you know what's really crazy? I remember Super Bowl 23. Anybody remember Super Bowl 23? Exactly. You see, on the scale of eternal significance, it's really not that significant. It really isn't. And I know Sid can go over there and count his seven stinking Steelers Super Bowl rings and all that, but seven, is it, Siski? Six. Okay, six Super Bowl rings. Any rate, I'm bummed out now. See, I shouldn't have got to talk about football. I'm a Viking fan. I get bummed out. But when it comes to significance, really, guys, really, Jesus is more significant than the NFL. I know we can debate that sometimes. Some of you want to debate that. There's really no debate there. So we're not even going to debate it. I'm just going to say it because someone should say it. Now, you know I'm an avid sports fan, so I'm not against sports. I love sports. But Jesus loves me. And I'm going to respond to that. Jesus doesn't charge you to come to him. Jesus paid the price for you. He's got eternal rewards for you. That's our Jesus. So the shepherds, they see Jesus. And that's what they do. They receive that message by faith. They respond to that message with instant obedience. They tell others. They report to others. They return to their life. But they're new now. They're changed. And they rejoice. They rejoice in Christ. They rejoice in having met the Messiah. That's why we celebrate Christmas. It's not about the Christmas trees. And I want to thank all of you. This is the first year in maybe 30 years of ministry that someone hasn't come to me with the Jeremiah verse. Now, you can do it today, later, I guess, if you want to keep it going. But there's a verse in Jeremiah that says, well, you know, the Christmas tree is really pagan worship. Because it says in Jeremiah, they went into the mountains, cut off trees, put them in the house, decorated them with decorations, and fell down and worshipped them. That's why we don't have a Christmas tree. Because we don't want to worship the trees. And I'm here to tell you, if you don't want to have a Christmas tree, then don't have a Christmas tree. It's all right. You don't have to have a Christmas tree. If you have a Christmas tree, well, then have a Christmas tree. It's all right. You can have a Christmas tree. That has nothing to do with Jesus unless you're bowing down and worshiping that tree. But if you are, and when people come, this is the I'm going to say it, if you come, if truly we are worshiping that tree, then we want to be rejoicing in January, because the biggest revival in the world takes place every January when people go into their homes, take down that tree. Many of them burn them, haul them to the dump, other than put them in a box, stick them up in the attic somewhere. That's a great thing if that's what we're worshiping, but we're not worshiping a tree. Most people, when you ask, why do you do a tree, we don't even know why, what the Christian significance of it is. We just do it because we're American. We have a tree. Okay. Put a tree up. That's cool. Put a tree up there. But it's like, why do we have a tree? What's the point? Why? Does anybody know why we have a tree? You don't know, do you? I'm not going to tell you. We did a strong teaching on it about 4 years ago. You can just get all the December teachings and you'll find it in there, a long old thing on the tree, or you can Google it, that's easier. But the Christian reason, symbolism behind all the greenery is amazing. Okay, I'll tell you. But the green was brought in originally in the pagan holiday of Saturnalia to remind people that the days are getting longer and there's going to be life again coming onto the planet. So it's evergreen. We bring it now, isn't this awesome, evergreen? So the tree and the evergreen, whether it's holly or mistletoe, whatever the green was, the Christians took that and said, that's a reminder of us that those things stay green all year round. It helps us remember that because of Jesus, the unconquerable Son, if we believe in Him, we'll never die. So the Christmas tree, really from a Christian ancient history, 1,700 years ago, the tree was a symbol of eternity and the everlasting life we have because of Jesus. So when we're decorating a tree, realize the purpose of that from a Christian perspective is, I put my faith in Jesus, I'm going to live forever because of Jesus, not because of me. And not because of that tree, but because of the blood of Jesus Christ and the resurrection of Jesus Christ and who Jesus is. There's been a little bit of controversy lately. Pastor Andy Stanley, and I've got nothing but good things to say about Pastor Andy Stanley. I love his dad, Charles Stanley. I listened to him for years. They're a great family. Yeah, they've had their stuff, but that's a good family. They love the Lord. Some of you probably heard Pastor Andy Stanley was teaching in Atlanta this past week, and he brought up, I'm off the side of the pulpit now, right? But he brought up and says, you know, Christianity is not founded on the virgin birth. He says, even if the virgin birth didn't take place, that's all right. As long as Jesus died and rose again, that's all that matters. And he has taken such a hit on that. And I feel so bad for him. And he's going to retract it. Not yet, but I'm sure he will. But those of you that ever taught or spoken to anybody about Jesus, you know, you can get excited and say something. And to make a point, you might say something that might not be the best. But I'm here to tell you, if there is no virgin birth, we're going to hell. Because Jesus doesn't qualify to be the Savior. If he was born through the bloodline of Joseph, that bloodline got cursed. Those of you in the Old Testament survey know. Jeconiah, Coniah, whatever you want to call him, he's got a couple of names there. God cursed that line and said, his descendant will never sit on the throne, ever. That disqualified. You better know the demons were rejoicing. It's in Jeremiah, I think, 21, 22, 22. And they're rejoicing. They're rejoicing. Because God just cursed the messianic line. But then we go to Matthew. And we see the genealogy of Jesus. And there's Jeconiah. Uh-oh. And then it goes from Jeconiah all the way down. And there sits Joseph in that line. Joseph is in the cursed line, but it's a positional thing because those are the lines of the kings of Israel. So Jesus is qualified to be the king of Israel because of his dad Joseph, but he's disqualified if Joseph is his dad because that line's cursed. What a dilemma. And you can imagine the demonic realm extremely rejoicing with this. They said, our battle's over. Hey, it worked. God cursed his own line. You know they partied. You know they did. But then we go into Luke chapter 3 and we see the genealogy of Mary. And it gets just way cool. Because it says that her dad was a guy named Heli, H-E-L-I. And you start going back up that, boink, 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 boink. And it comes even with Jeconiah in Joseph's line. And you come over here and there's no Jeconiah. And you keep going back, and pretty soon they both go back to David.
Yes.
And you go, wait a minute now. So David had Solomon,
yes,
and Rehoboam, and bum-pa-da-bum-pa-da-bum, Jeconiah cursed. But he had other kids. One of his sons, and I personally believe, it doesn't tell us, but I personally believe this son was probably born after David fell, because he names him after the prophet that confronted David and brought him to repentance. And those of you that are in sin right now, you know how you're trying to avoid that one person that'll tell you the way it is. You ever, you know, we all know who that is. It's like, okay, I'm in sin, I'm smiling, life is good, but I don't want to talk one-on-one with that one because she'll call me out and that's not going to be good. So we just stay away from that person. You know who it is. But all of a sudden you're at the grocery store minding your own business. Maybe you're just, what, buying a six-pack or something of Coke. And you're there. And you're there. And around the corner comes that person that you most dread. And they go, Merry Christmas. And you're going, and you just got guilt. All, you know you're red. You know you're, you can't even look at him or her. You're just like, morning, Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas. Good to see you. Got to go. You know. And they say, brother, sister, come here. Let's talk. What's going on in your life, man? And they lovingly tell you, what are you doing? God loves you. He loves you so much. I want to help you, brother. Come on back. I want to help you, sister. Come on back. And the person we feared the most ends up being, God, thank you so much for that person to have the guts to talk to me. I thought he's going to kill me. He didn't kill me. He loved me. What? I believe that prophet Nathan that confronted David, I'm away from the pulpit, my opinion, don't write this down, my opinion. But I do know in the genealogy line of David, he had a boy after Solomon. And I know he named him Nathan, the guy that confronted him. Now, maybe he was before Nathan, but I bet not. But if we go to Nathan's son and Nathan's son and Nathan's sons, you go 28 generations down there, there's Heli being born. And he has a little girl. He calls her Mary. So Mary has the bloodline of David, but not through Jeconiah, whose bloodline was cursed. So these two, all the way down through those bloodlines, way down here, either Joseph's parents and Mary's parents, or Joseph just looked at Mary and said, hey, they got betrothed. Had no idea that God had his hand in it. Isn't that wonderful when you see the hand of God bringing your mate to you? And you look back and you see it, and you know, I didn't see that. God had that, didn't he? Joseph is older than Mary. By quite a little bit, most people believe. Mary was typical marrying age. She was around 12 or 13, they believe. And Joseph is older because he was older. Interesting. But here they are, and they come together. You see, if Joseph was the biological father of Jesus, Jesus is disqualified.
Amen.
Because of that curse of Jeconiah, that God cursed that line. So to say the virgin birth isn't necessary, Dr. Stanley knows that. He got excited. I can't say what happened, but I do not believe that that was a well thought out statement. I believe everything in me, he was making a comparison. You need to know that Jesus died. And if you're struggling with a virgin birth, forget about it. Let's talk about, that's where he's going. And now people are kind of trying to cut down another pastor. I look at Paul's letters to the pastors, to Timothy and Titus. He wrote three letters to the pastors. The only three letters that Paul wrote, out of all 14 of his letters, only three of them, every letter, almost every letter, Paul says, grace and peace, grace and peace, grace and peace, but not to the pastors. The only time he writes to the pastors, all three times he writes to the pastors, he doesn't say grace and peace. He says grace, mercy, and peace. Cut Stanley some slack.
Yes.
Extend some mercy. He loves the Lord. God is using him. He'll get that straightened out, but don't take sides. The reason I'm bringing this up is I've had texts from a lot of you. I agree with them. I disagree with them. Calm down. Calm down. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. The virgin birth is a necessity. We can stand on the scripture on that. That goes without saying. So let's just extend a lot of mercy, a lot of love. Calm yourself. Maybe, just maybe, maybe Charles Stanley and Andy Stanley aren't perfect. I don't know. Maybe. Calm down. Calm down. It's okay. They're good men. Let's go forward. All right? So we're celebrating the virgin birth. We're celebrating the birth of Jesus. Whenever it happened, we're just glad it happened. And we're just going to love each other, going to love the Lord. We thank the Lord for what he's done. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, I want to introduce you to him. It's the bomb. It's amazing. The Bible tells us that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Every one of us, we're all sinners. The Bible says there's not one righteous. Nope, not one. Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That's what we're celebrating. That whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I want to encourage you today to become a whosoever. Whosoever believes in him. Think about that. Think about that. Now, those of you who know Jesus right now, I want you to be praying quietly where you're at. God, move in our midst. Ask God to draw people to him. This is the most important day for some of us in here that we'll ever have in eternity. This is the day. This is the day. In the Gospel of John in chapter 1, verse 12, it says, as many as received Jesus, to them he gave the right to become a child of God. You can be a child of God by receiving the Lord. That's it. We give gifts now. The reason we give gifts is to remember the gift that God gave us. But what good is a gift if we don't receive it? Roman can come over to my place and I can give Roman this beautiful gift wrapped up in this beautiful box and bow and say, Roman, this is for you. This gift is for you, man. It's going to change your life. Now, Roman can go, woohoo, open that gift up. He can throw it in the backseat of the car and 4 years from now, oh yeah, under the blanket, there's that gift. I forgot about that. That gift means nothing unless he receives it and opens it up. The Lord has given us a gift, and that gift is Jesus himself. We can receive him, have him come into our life. We can open up the gift, if you will, as we acknowledge the fact that we're sinners and we choose to place our faith in Jesus. That's it. You don't have to do anything. It's not a matter of joining a church. It's not a matter of saying a prayer a certain way. It's not that. It's you receiving what God has done for you to forgive you of your sins so you can have a relationship with your God. Simple as that. Jesus called it in John 3, being born again. John wrote much later in 1 John, if we confess our sins, he is faithful. He is just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We can be cleansed. There might be consequences to our sin, but we'll be cleansed of our sin. And it's an amazing thing what God does when we truly repent of our sin and turn from it. Even the consequences, he turns into blessings. It's the most amazing thing. He's done it in my life, and I know he can do it in yours. But it's a matter of setting everything down and acknowledging the fact that Jesus Christ is God, that he was born to a virgin. He lived a sin-free life. He went to the cross. He died on that cross. He rose from the dead. He's alive today. And right now, December 25th, that's pretty easy to remember. December 25th, 2016, you have an opportunity to place the little bit of faith that all of us have. You have the opportunity to place that faith in Jesus Christ, his shed blood. Jesus Christ, truly God, truly man. Jesus Christ, who died for you and rose from the dead, is alive today. You can place your faith in him and have the forgiveness of sins and the hope of eternal life, the promise of eternal life. That's the gift that God is going to offer to you today. Don't have to receive it. But man, why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you want all that God has for you? I mean, this is just me. The gift I'm going to give Roman in that box wasn't that all that hot. It's a little gift. And Roman could say, no, I don't want it. Well, that's fine. I'll just give it to Walter. Take that tag off. Walter, you want a gift? You know, it's no big thing. I don't care. But it's just a little gift. But the gift of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of your sins, the promise of everlasting life, God will come and dwell in you and flow through you. You will find his perfect will, that mystery we've been talking about in Ephesians 3. Hello, guys. So I'm going to give you an offer. We're going to pray. Don't have to. But if you want to, I would love and be honored to let God speak through a prayer as he gives you the gift of salvation. It has nothing to do with me, has nothing to do with this church. This is you and God. But I know my Bible tells me he loves you, and I know my Bible tells you he'll forgive you. I know my Bible tells you he'll restore you. I know you can have a relationship with the Lord again. Maybe you've drifted away, but I'm here to tell you, God will bring you back right now. There's no reason not to have a relationship with Jesus, guys. So let's pray. And in this prayer, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm not going to have you come down here right away. I'm just going to have you raise your hand. And if you say with me, when I come to that point, say, well, if you want that, just raise your hand. We'll pray with you. We'll just pray with you. We're not going to call you out. We're just going to pray with you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much again for this time of year when we just remember as a nation, as a world, we remember your incarnation, you coming and being born into a sinful world that we might have life. God, we thank you so much for your love for us. And Lord, as we just read through the Christmas story again, Lord, today with the emphasis there on those shepherds, God, we can relate with them so well. And Lord, here we are, many of us, in the world's eyes, Lord, we kind of get looked down upon. We don't seem to really be what the world says we should be. But Lord, we see here in the story this morning that you go to those who the world calls foolish, those the world kicks aside. Lord, you reach out to sinners. Many of us here, Lord, we have prayed a prayer where we have placed our faith in you, but Lord, it's so easy, as we saw in Ephesians 2 there, to start to live our life according to the world, according to the prince of the power of this world, to the lust of our flesh, to get off path. But Lord, we also saw that you are rich in grace. And Lord, it's the blood of Jesus that draws us close again. So whether you're here today and you just want to become part of the family of God, you're sitting here today, you know you're a sinner, and you are ready to pay the price. And the price for you is taking the little bit of faith that God has given you and placing it in Jesus. Stop trusting yourself. Stop putting your faith in your abilities and say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I'm placing my faith in you. That's it. God will take it from there. Just come to Jesus. Or maybe you're here today and you've had an experience like that. Maybe you rededicated your life to the Lord 27 times. Well, here's number 28. And if you're here today and say, I just need to come back to Christ. I've slipped away. Either through whatever. Who cares? I did it. But I'm ready to come back to Jesus. I'm ready to walk with him. I'm ready to serve him. I'm ready to truly live a Christian life again. And if you're either one of those two categories and you say, I just want some prayer. I just want some prayer. Everyone's eyes are closed. Say, just pray for me. Just put your hand up and put it down right away and say, please pray for me. God bless you guys. God bless you. God bless you. Anyone else? Say, just pray for me. God bless you over there. Anyone else? God bless you. And you too, God bless you. Got you in the back there, God bless you. Let's pray. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord, as sinners. Lord, we acknowledge our sin to you. If this is the first time you've ever prayed this, guys, repeat after me, just softly where you are. Jesus, I do believe that you are God. Jesus, I do believe that you rose from the dead after paying the price for my sin.
Just run with the stone.
And I pray, Lord, that you would receive me into your family. I place my faith in Jesus. I confess that I'm a sinner, and I place my faith in you. Jesus, thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying for me. I believe you are alive today at the right hand of my Father. Fill me, Lord, with your Holy Spirit. Come upon me with your Holy Spirit. I give my life to you. For those of us that are rededicated, we might pray something like this. You know how to pray, guys. God, forgive me. Lord, I'm coming back. I bow at your feet. Thank you for loving me, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.